Today we continue in our sermon series in Ecclesiastes. And of course today's title is The Search Continues, and we're in Ecclesiastes chapter 2. I hope that you'll actually have that open in front of you. We're going to be doing a lot of reading from chapter 2 of Ecclesiastes, and it's important for you to see it. So let's go ahead and go before God in prayer, and then we'll get right into the message. Father, we are so thankful always for all that you give us in life. Father, we're thankful for this book of Ecclesiastes. Even though, Lord, when we read it, it seems so hard to understand and it seems almost depressing. Father, we understand that as Solomon is talking about it, he's reviewing a life that was not well lived. So, Father, be with us, because the fact is, quite frankly, a lot of the things we are talking about last week and even today, Lord, they apply to us. We see that they're very much alive and well in our lives today. Help us to be open to hear what your word would have to say to us, and help us to become the people, Father, that you want us to be, so that as Solomon would say himself, that we might make wiser choices in our life than even he did. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, so last week we started the sermon series in the book of Ecclesiastes, and Ecclesiastes is a tough book to understand. It is very blunt. It seems very depressing, and if you're not careful, it gives you the impression there is no hope at all, that everything is meaningless. But believe it or not, that is not the message at all that Solomon is trying to convey to his listeners. Solomon has gathered an audience, and he wants to share with them how to learn from a life that's mostly been lived without honoring God, which is mostly his life. What happens when we pursue things other than God with the same absolute intensity we are called to pursue God with? What happens when we do that? Well, the answer is simple. You get lukewarm Christians who really don't take their walk very serious at all. And sadly, what happens when that happens in our life is simply this. We wind up with spiritually inept Christians, which eventually leads to spiritually inept churches and ultimately a spiritually inept society. That sounds a whole lot like where we live today, isn't it? Please hear me when I say this, Christians. You and I are called to be preservative in this world. We are to help stop or at least slow down the decay of souls. But how do we do that? Well, we become salt. Matthew chapter 5, verse 13. You are the salt of the earth. But if salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and be trampled by men. A society of Christians in name only isn't preserving anything at all, including, by the way, themselves. We must pursue God with a moral intensity like we have never pursued him before. And that is how we grow. And when we grow, we will impact those around us. Now, I want you to think back to last week for a moment. I want you to remember the two questions that I ask you to ponder through this entire series. Number one, can a person know God yet not have him present in their life? And the answer to that is absolutely yes. Think about Cain, King Saul, Ahab and Jezebel, just to name a few. Maybe even your own name belongs on that list. But then there was a second question. And that is simply this. Can a person really understand the deeper meanings of life without knowing God? And the answer is no. If you are not truly connected with the source of all wisdom and all knowledge, how could you ever know the deeper meanings of life or anything else for that matter? To the person who lives as a Christian in name only, they often say to themselves, look, I'm not a bad person. I try to help others. I don't harm people. I attend church when it's convenient. I don't share my faith. I don't talk about religion. I'm not involved in any kind of Bible study that I might grow. I don't have time for those things right now. Maybe later, maybe when I'm older, maybe when my life slows down. But you and I know this, that never happens. Life doesn't slow down. If you're riding a horse full speed and you decide you need to slow down because you see a cliff up ahead, you better take the horse by the reins because you're going to have to take control. You're going to have to make something happen. You see, it doesn't just happen on its own. But there are still will be some today that will say, come on, Bob, I'll cross that bridge when I get there. But Solomon describes that kind of thinking as well in the book of Proverbs. Listen to his advice. We talked about it last week. Proverbs 12:15, the way of the fool seems right to him, but the wise man listens to advice. Or Proverbs 19:20, listen to advice and accept instruction, and in the end, you will be wise. So I will say to you again today, as Solomon said to all of us so many years ago, don't be foolish. Listen to his advice, heed his instruction, and maybe, just maybe, you'll be wiser and make better choices in your life than Solomon did most of his. So here is the philosophical and theological dilemma that we all face. And that is simply this. We often try to walk two journeys in our life, and we try to walk them at the same time. We walk one journey in our physical life, and then we try to walk the other journey mentally in our life. You see, we look really good from the outside. You have the degree that you want. You have the house that you want. You have the money that you want. You have the spouse that you want. You excel at a sport that you want. And you have the job you want. But you keep asking yourself quietly, why am I not happy? I mean, why isn't this enough for me? In other words, the veneer looks really great, but on the inside, you're all busted up. You have no idea what to do. Morally, you look great, but spiritually, you don't know any more about the Bible than you did when you first became a Christian. You're not growing, and you're not happy in your walk at all with Jesus Christ. So let's keep walking through Ecclesiastes with Solomon. We have this great preacher who says, come and have a seat, because I want to warn you about a few things that you might want to be warned about so that you can avoid. That way, you'll have a happy life. And so here we are today. The search continues. So the first point I want us to look at is simply this. Whatever you want, it's yours. Now, turn with me and look with me, if you will, in Ecclesiastes 2. I'm going to be reading verses 1 through 11. I thought in my heart, come now, I will test you with pleasure to find out what is good, because that also proves to be meaningless. Laughter, I said, is foolish. And what does pleasure accomplish? I tried cheering myself with wine and embracing folly. My mind still guided me with wisdom. I wanted to see what was worthwhile for men to do under heaven during the few days of their life. I undertook great projects. I built houses for myself. I planted vineyards. I made gardens and parks and planted all kinds of fruit trees in them. I made reservoirs of water, groves of flourishing trees. I bought male and female slaves. I had other slaves that were born in my house. I also owned more herds and flocks than anyone in Jerusalem before me. I amassed silver and gold for myself and the treasures of kings and provinces. I acquired men and women singers and a harem as well. The delight of the heart of man. I became greater by far than anyone in Jerusalem before me. In all this, my wisdom stayed with me. I denied myself nothing my eyes desired. I refused my heart no pleasure. My heart took delight in all my work, and this was the reward for my labor. Yet, when I surveyed all my hands had done, and what I had toiled to achieve, everything was meaningless, a chasing after the wind. Nothing was gained under the sun. I want you to know that Solomon had it all. Now, I mean it. Solomon had it all. Think about that for a moment. Solomon had the riches of a kingdom, the power and the admiration of a king, and the manpower to accomplish anything he wanted. So in chapter 1, Solomon sought to better understand the thinking of men and why life seems meaningless, because everything seems to follow that tick-tock, clickety-clock redundancy that always has been and seems to always will be. But then we remember we must also ask ourselves, can a man or can a person really know the deeper meaning of life without knowing God or having him present in life? And the answer is no. You see, Solomon himself will later acknowledge that, and we'll eventually get there. But think about what it must have looked like to be a person on the outside watching Solomon on the inside. I mean, not only is he really smart, he's a good-looking man. He has several nice houses. He has beautiful gardens and groves of trees, reservoirs of water in order to water every one of them, numerous flocks and herds, plenty of great food to eat, and literally tons of silver and gold. But Solomon adds this, I even had a harem, a delight of man's heart. Now let me be specific about this harem. I want you to listen to 1 Kings chapter 11, verse 3. This is what it reads. He had 700 wives of royal birth and 300 concubines, and his wives led him astray. Now, I want to make sure that we understand that. I want you to think about it. If Solomon decided that he wanted to have a date night with all of his wives and his concubines, to start at number one, by the time he would come back to her, it would be 2.7 years. 2.7 years with a date night every night. That's pretty amazing. Nothing says love to a wife but standing in line behind 999 other women who want the admiration of her husband. Nothing says love better than that. So from the outside, Solomon had it all. He wanted for nothing. He was building the temple of God. Everyone thought no one was closer to God than Solomon. And yet, that was not the case at all. Solomon could not have been farther from God. Why? Because of materialism. And according to scriptures, because of his wives. The people that were closest to him in his life were whispering in his ear, I know a God that can give you something better than your God. Now, I'm not going to stand here today and lecture about materialism. The fact is, quite frankly, I think everybody understands that the insatiable desire to have more and more stuff will always cause your walk with the Lord to be deteriorated and to diminish. And having the things in your life is not bad. So don't get me wrong. As long as they do not control your life to the point that keeping them controls your decision-making and your walk with Jesus. Solomon says in chapter 2, verse 1, come, now I will test you with pleasure. And in chapter 2, verse 10, I denied myself nothing my eyes desired. I refused my heart no pleasure. I'm going to be honest with you. Doesn't that sound a whole lot like most people we know today? Now, somebody's probably thinking, come on, Bob, we can't afford the stuff that Solomon did, and you're right. But, quite frankly, the pursuit of all of our desires really doesn't take the money of a king anymore. All you need to be willing to do is to waste your money and go deep in debt, and you'll fulfill all your desires and all the desires of your children as well. And I want us to be aware of what Solomon says. He says, test you with pleasure. As if, by the way, pleasure is bad. I want to make sure that we also understand that God gives us all the ability to have pleasure in our life. But the only time those pleasures are good for us when they are within the context and the boundaries that God sets. Now, outside those boundaries, it can become very sinful and it can become very vile. Bill Hybels actually tells a story of someone, and he says these words. All he really wanted in life was more. He wanted more money. And so he parlayed inherited wealth into a $1 billion pile of assets. He wanted more fame. And so he broke into Hollywood scene and became a filmmaker and a star. He wanted more sensual pleasure. So he paid handsome sums to indulge his every sexual urge. He wanted more thrills. And so he designed, built, and piloted the fastest aircraft in the world. He wanted more power. And so he secretly dealt political favors so skillfully that two U.S. presidents literally became his pawns. All he ever wanted was more. He was absolutely convinced that more would bring him true satisfaction. Unfortunately, history shows otherwise. He concluded his life emaciated, colorless, sunken chest, fingernails in grotesque inch-long corkscrews, rotting black teeth, tumors, and innumerable needle marks in his arm from his drug addiction. Howard Hughes died believing the myth of more. He died a billionaire junkie, insane by all reasonable standards. Many Christians today pursue sports with the notion that I'm going to be the best at this sport and therefore I'm going to be famous. I'm going to make lots of money. I'll want for nothing, only to find themselves broken down at the age of 40, wondering why in the world they damaged their body so bad, lost their childhood, and greatly damaged their faith. It was meaningless. Many Christians pursue their careers with such zeal that they put their families and they put their faith on a shelf. They pledge an allegiance to a company or to a boss or to a pay scale, and they do so with more devotion than Jesus Christ ever receives from them, only to find out one day it was meaningless. Many Christian parents tell their children, enjoy life while you're young. You only get to do it once, so do everything. Don't hold back on anything, only for their children to grow up as adults, regretting half of the decisions they made in their life because it did damage. It was meaningless. Many Christians are told if you have the right degree, the right pay scale, the right job, the right spouse, you can have all the confidence in the world and there is nothing you cannot do. But without Jesus, it is meaningless. Listen to Philippians chapter 3, verses 4 through 8. If, and this is what Paul says, if anyone else thinks he has reason to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, in regard to the law, a Pharisee, as for zeal, persecuting the church, as for legalistic righteousness, faultless. But whatever was to my profit, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them rubbish that I might gain Christ. Can a person know God yet not have him present in their life? The answer to that is yes. Can a person truly understand the deeper meaning of life without knowing God? And the answer to that is no. Solomon said, I have everything a person could ever want and much more. But without God, in the end, it is meaningless. It's like chasing the wind. You'll never catch it. I don't know how you feel about your life right now. Are you running yourself into the dirt, trying to always get ahead? Are you so worn out from sporting events and other obligations that your spiritual life has stalled or maybe even flatlined? If Solomon could not find happiness without God, what in the world makes you think you can? You don't have the stuff at your disposal that Solomon did, so if he couldn't do it, how can you? How can I? How can we? Matthew chapter 16, verse 26 says, what good is it if a man gains the whole world, yet forfeits his own soul? Or what can a man give in exchange for his soul? Let me ask you that question. What is your soul worth? Another pay raise? Another sports trophy or medallion? Another job with a few more dollars per hour? Your pride? Is it worth your integrity or another skill or another degree? When you are allowing the world to whisper in your ears like Solomon's wives, I know another God that can give you more than yours. Because I will tell you this, like Solomon says here, whatever you are chasing, if it is not Jesus Christ, it is meaningless, it's like chasing the wind, and you will never catch it. And that'll take us this morning to our next point. And that is simply this, we are all alike in one sense. Ecclesiastes chapter 2, verse 12, then I turned my thoughts to consider wisdom, and also madness and folly. Now what I want us to notice here is that Solomon is now seeking the difference between a man who thinks about what he's doing in his life and a man who does not think about what he is doing in his life. Folly, by definition, is the opposite of wisdom. In other words, a person of folly is a person who does not do much thinking at all, and that is the reason why the Bible refers to a person of folly as a fool. Psalm chapter 14, verse 1, the fool says in his heart, there is no God. The insinuation here is very simple. A finite being, which is what we humans are, we are finite, means we are limited in everything that we do, including, by the way, our thinking, to make such an absolute statement that there is no God, in spite of all the evidence, makes you an absolute non-thinking fool. That's what Scripture says. Not me, but I agree. But not only was Solomon looking at man's ability to think as well as his ability to not think, Solomon was also exploring man's ability in his folly to throw himself mindlessly into his desires. That's what we spoke about in the first part of this sermon, by the way. And that is what Solomon calls madness. Madness is the desire to want more, to do more, to have more stuff in your life. But what Solomon, why is he calling it madness? Because you're never satisfied with what you have. You're always wanting the newest and the best. And that is what he calls madness. Why isn't what you have right here and right now in your life good enough for you? Now that's something that you have to think about. Why isn't what you have right here and right now in your life, why is that not good enough for you? Why is it that every 2 years you have to have the newest smartphone? Why is it smart to pay $1,000 for a phone? I'm just saying. Maybe it's smart for the company, not so much for the consumer. Why is it that you have to have the newest car among your friends or the group of people that you're around, even though you can't afford it? You do it because you want an image. You do it to fulfill your own desire. Why is it that we have to always one-up those living around us? Why is it that it's our desire to not only keep up with society, we follow the madness of the world, which is folly? Because in order to be so bad at managing what God has given us, we cannot be thinking clearly. And that's what Solomon says is madness. Solomon adds this thought to his process as well in verse 12. What more can the king's successor do that has not already been done? That is to say this, I've done it all. I've built it all. I've thought about it. I made it happen. The successor will not want or should not want for much more at all. However, the madness and the folly of man, he will not be happy with what there is. And how true that is. So I want you to think about your own situation for a moment. I want you just to think internally for your own situation. What do you think would make you happy? Now just think about that. In a recent article titled Happiness Trends Shock Social Scientists, wrote by a friend of mine that I think probably several of you know, Clay Warnick, in the September edition of the River Times, he said some pretty great stuff about society today. Now I'm summarizing this, but this is what he said. Clay talks about the world in which we now live. He says it's amazing that our family, our past family members, our great-grandparents, our great-great-grandparents, and so on and so forth, most of them that lived in this area never ever saw a lobster in their entire life. And now you and I, we can go to the local Kroger in Kentucky and we can see lobsters live inside of a tank. We can buy them live. But then he also brings up the fact that our grandparents would probably also be very amazed at the toys that we spend our money on. Clay then adds that we live in a society that now what was only once reserved for the rich is now available to every single one of us, and yet we are still not happy. 11% of U.S. citizens over the age of 12, now listen to this, 11% of U.S. citizens over the age of 12 are taking Prozac, Effexor, or other mood stabilizers. So despite the economies worldwide that allow us to have whatever we want for little to no work, we still have the highest levels of anxiety and depression in the world. Clay then adds these words, and social scientists are now amazed that there is no link between cash and joy. So the big question is, if big money and material possessions are not the ticket to happiness, then what is? Clay offers a few ideas for the reader. Maybe that might be helpful, but he also mentions in those ideas that obviously a person's faith and the fact that we enjoy being around happy people as opposed to pessimistic people. But what is it that gives you true happiness? And I mean the true sense of happiness in your life. It certainly cannot be the madness and the folly of this world, is it? I mean, we know that that can't be. Solomon says in verse 14, the wise man has eyes to see while the fool walks in darkness. And that's to say this, at least the wise man will think about what he's about to do, where the fool will just run headlong into danger and not think twice at all. But Solomon also states the truth of the case. And that's this, he says, the same fate overtakes both. Verse 16, for the wise man, like the fool, will not be long remembered. In the days to come, both will be forgotten. Like the fool, the wise man too must die. So that brings us to another moral dilemma in our life. If I cannot find true lasting happiness with all my toys, if I cannot find true lasting happiness with all my trophies, with my bank account, with my degree or degrees, with my job, or with all the stuff I accumulate, then what is it that brings me true, lasting happiness? Well, the fact is, if it's not something of this world, then it has to be of the world to come, right? I mean, it must be that eternity with Jesus Christ. Now, that's the pearl of great price. True, lasting happiness must be connected to something that is not connected with this world, the here and now. Consider what the Hebrew writer says in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27. Just as a man is destined to die once and then face the judgment. Let me ask you a question. Do you believe that biblical statement? I really hope that you do, because it is truth. And if you believe it, does it matter to you that maybe your life is not where it needs to be with Jesus Christ? So many people hold on so tight to the things that ultimately do not matter. But when something goes wrong, it's usually then we find out what matters most. After Hurricane Harvey hit Texas, a man was interviewed by a television reporter. He had totally lost everything on his property. And of course, his property looked very, very high priced. And the reporter said this to the man, "Will your insurance cover all that you have lost?" To which the man responded, quote unquote, "I'm not sure, but I have my wife, I have my kids, and that's all that really matters to me." And it's true, isn't it? If someone calls you and tells you that one of your loved ones was just in a car accident, the first question that comes out of your mouth isn't, "How's the car?" That's not your first question. You don't care about the car. You don't care if it's destroyed. You don't care if it's ruined. You care about the loved one that was inside the car. But it usually takes something like that for us to admit what's important to us. It's not the toy. It's not the stuff. It's the person. It's the soul that matters more to you and I than anything else. Sadly, most people will buzz through life and never think seriously about the relationship with Jesus Christ until their life is about to be over. And then their family wonders as they weep. Or they even try to convince themselves, like, "Everything's okay. I think they believed in God." But they're never for sure about that. While they're in the room of the dying loved one with tears streaming down their face, that question not only haunts the person passing, but also the family that's there. Are they saved in Christ? Are they going to heaven? Have they lived a life that honors Jesus, or did they waste everything about their life? It haunts families. But unfortunately, sometimes it's not until you're in that deathbed area that you begin to think about it. In this room, no one cares about your college degrees. In that room, nobody cares if you were good at a sport. Nobody cares if you were the CEO or if you were a millionaire. Who cares about the fact that you might have 4 houses or 1,000 acres of land? You can't take it. So nobody cares about that stuff. You see, we are all alike in one sense, whether we are wise or foolish. We will all have to stand before our Creator and give an account for our life. Are you ready for that? That's the question. Are you ready to stand before your Creator and give an account of your life? Brothers and sisters, we should all live ready to die so we can die ready to live. Solomon says in verse 13, "I saw that wisdom was better than folly, just as light is better than darkness. Be wise today, and I pray that you choose to walk in the light of Christ and not in the darkness of the world." Which will take us this morning to our last point. And that is simply this: where can I find joy? Ecclesiastes chapter 2, verses 17 through 21, if you want to follow along. It says, "So I hated life, because the work that is done under the sun was grievous to me. All of it is meaningless, a chasing after the wind. I hated all the things I had toiled for under the sun, because I must leave them to one who will come after me. And who knows whether he will be a wise man or a fool? Yet he will have control over all the things I put work into, and I have poured my effort and skill under the sun. This too is meaningless. So my heart began to despair over all my toilsome labor under the sun. For a man may have his work with wisdom, knowledge, and skill, and then he must leave it to one, then he must leave it all to someone who has not worked for it. This too is meaningless and a great misfortune. What does a man get from all of his toil and anxious striving with which he labors under the sun? All of his days of work are painful and grief. Even at night, his mind does not rest. This too is meaningless. A man can do nothing better than to eat, drink, and find satisfaction in his work. This too, I see, is from the hand of God. For without him, who could eat or find enjoyment? To the man who pleases him, God gives wisdom, knowledge, and happiness. But to the sinner, he gives the task of gathering and storing up wealth to hand it over to the one who pleases God. This too is meaningless, a chasing after the wind." Now, I want you to hear what Solomon is saying in this passage. And I know that it hits home with many people. And I want to point out 5 things that he says. Listen to this. Verse 17, "I hated life Verse 18, I hated all my labor. Verse 20, I had despair, which by the way is depression, over all that I had done. Verse 21, all I do is accomplish, earn, and build, just simply to give it to somebody who doesn't earn it. But listen to verse 23. All his days, his work, his pain, and his grief, but even at night, my mind does not rest. Doesn't that sound extremely depressing? I think it does, and yet that's most of America today. That's most of the world today. That's most of the church today. Remember chapters 1 and 2 of Ecclesiastes or Solomon talking about what it looks like to live a life with no real connection to God whatsoever. It's searching for everything in life that'll fill that hole that only God can fill in your life. Can a person know God yet not have him present in his life? The answer to that is absolutely yes. Solomon says the major dilemma that we all must face is simply this, that when we put into all of life, all of our worrying, all of our sleepless nights, all my stuff will eventually be given to someone who didn't even work for it, and they may not take care of it. They may even do foolish stuff with it. Now, I want to point something out here that may seem trivial to you, but it's not, and that is simply this. In verse 24, it reads these words, a man can do nothing better than to eat, drink, and find satisfaction in his work. This too, I see, is from the hand of God. In the original text, the word better is not there. It was added by the writers or by the interpreters. It's not there. Now, that may seem trivial to you, and you may wonder why I've even pointed that out. Well, here's the reason why. Because there is something better than food and water and work, and that is a proper relationship with Jesus. But the fact is, do notice where Solomon says satisfaction in this world comes from. The hand of God. The journey that Solomon is talking or taking you and I on starts to lead you and I back to the one that you better know in your life and to the one that you better have a right relationship with. So please understand today, the facts are these and they are undisputed. The only way that you and I will ever have real satisfaction in our life is to be in a right relationship with God. Think back to the Garden of Eden. Adam had food, water, and work, and he was in complete and total, fully satisfied. Why? Because he was in complete harmony with God. His life was right with God. When did despair come into his life? When he stopped living under God and started living under the sun. That's when his relationship was broken. The only way to know good is to know God, and the only way to know joy is to be in a right relationship with him. Ultimately, life without God is meaningless and it is hopeless. It's like chasing the wind. You'll never catch it. John chapter 10, verse 10, Jesus said these words, the thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy, but I have come that you may have life and have it to the fullest. Can a person really understand the deeper meaning of life without knowing God? The answer is no. Regardless of who you are, the answer never changes. Solomon wraps up his thought process with these words that you and I should be thinking about deeply in our life, and that's verse 26. To the man who pleases him, God gives wisdom, knowledge, and happiness. But to the sinner, he gives the task of gathering and storing up wealth to hand it over to those who please God. This too is meaningless, a chasing after the wind. See, to the world, the ways of God make no sense whatsoever to them. And I don't want you to hear today that if you are in Christ or that if you're devoted to God, that there's a day coming that you're going to be very wealthy while you're here on the earth. Now, the fact is, that may well be the case, and that may happen to you, but that may also well not be the case. We have already concluded that true happiness and fulfillment does not come from the things of this world. You and I know that very well. And everything in this world will lead to nothing. It matters nothing. It's not as important as we think it is. So we already know that. True happiness, fulfillment, and joy, as Solomon says in verse 25, comes from the hand of God. Let me ask you a question. Are you worn out from life? Do you feel like you're on the carousel of hopelessness? Do you lay awake at night wondering how in the world you're going to get it all done? Has your walk with the Lord suffered because of your business or because of your pursuit of stuff? I pray that you don't feel like Solomon felt, where he said, I hated life. I hated my labor. I had despair. I had depression over all that I have done. All that I do, all that I accomplish, all that I earn, all that I build is just going to go to somebody who didn't earn it. All the days of my life are filled with pain and grief, and even at night, my mind doesn't rest. I hope you don't feel that way. Because Jesus said in John chapter 10, verse 10, the thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. But I have come that you might have life and have it to the fullest. What I'm about to say is not new, but it may be new to you. And that is simply this, that God loves you so much that he stepped out of eternity and into our world, and he went to Calvary's cross to take the burden of man upon him, all of our sin, that you and I might be able to have freedom, to be set free, to be able to come into the presence of God again. But why did he do that for you and I? Because you are not meaningless to him. Because you matter more to him than you could ever imagine. He doesn't care about the car. He doesn't care about the degree. He doesn't care about the bank. He doesn't care about your work. He cares about you. And that's why he did what he did. So get off the carousel of meaninglessness and step into faith, hope, and love. And we all know the greatest of these is love.